Om Amrudeshwariya Namaha. A very warm welcome to everyone joining in for today's satsang. In the previous satsang, our Pooja Swami Amrita Geetananda Puri covered the topic of Ramarajyam according to Sage Vishwamitra. Sage Vishwamitra talks about Ramarajyam being a place where the younger generation bows down to the elders, whereas a place where the elders are forced to listen to the younger generation is called as a Yamarajyam. Sage Vishwamitra calls Sri Rama as Dharma Setu Palakaha, which means one who protects the bridge of Dharma. In today's satsang, Swamiji is going to talk about how Sri Rama built four bridges during his time. Day after tomorrow being Mahashivaratri, Swamiji is also going to talk about how Kailasam is a form of Ramarajyam. Ramarajya is a place where all living beings live in peace and harmony. And Kailasa is one such place. Swamiji will elaborate more on this topic during his satsang. Om Amrudeshwariya Namaha.
Om. ശ്രീ ഗുരുഭ്യോ നമ ഹരി ഓം ധ്യായ മൂധവളാവകുണ്ഠനവതീം തേജോമയീം നഷ്ടികീം നിഗ്ധാപാംഗവിലോകിനീം ഭഗവതീം മന്ദസ്മിതശ്രീമുഖീം വാത്സല്യാമൃതവർഷിണീം സുമധുരം സങ്കീർത്തനാലാപിനീം ശ്യാമാം ഗീമധുസിക്തസൂക്തിം അമൃതാനന്ദാത്മികാം ഈശ്വരീം ഓം അമൃതേശ്വരീ നമ ഗും ഗുരുഭ്യോ നമ ഓം ഗം ഗണപതേ നമ ഓം ഹാ സരസ്വതേ നമ ഓം മൈ ഇൻഫിനിറ്റ് പ്രോസ്ട്രേഷൻസ് ടു ദ ലോട്ടസ് ഫീറ്റ് ഓഫ് അമ്മ യൂണിവേഴ്സൽ ടീച്ചർ യൂണിവേഴ്സൽ മദർ മൈ ഹംബിൾ പ്രണാംസ് ടു ഓൾ അമ്മാസ് ബിലവ്ഡ് ചിൽഡ്രൻ ഇൻ ദ ലാസ്റ്റ് സെഷൻ വി ഹാഡ് സെഡ് ദാറ്റ് ദ സേജ് വിശ്വാമിത്ര ഹി ഗേവ് എ വെരി ബ്യൂട്ടിഫുൾ നെയിം ഫോർ ശ്രീരാമ ദ നെയിം വാസ് Dharma Setu Palakaha, one who maintains, one who protects the bridge of Dharma. Sage Vishwamitra also said that where the youngsters bow down and respect the elders, that is Ramarajya. And where the elders have to bow down and respect the youngsters, where the youngsters refuse to obey the elders, that is Yamarajya, that we have seen. And concerning the construction of bridges, we know that Sri Ramji and the Vanaras, they constructed one bridge that is very famous. We know the bridge connecting India and Lanka, where from the Tamil Nadu, South Tamil Nadu, Dhanushkodi, from Dhanushkodi, the bridge goes to Lanka. That bridge, we all of us know very well how the Vanaras constructed the bridge. When I was studying the Ramayana, one Acharya gave a very beautiful talk on how Sri Ramji constructed or Sri Ramji built four bridges. That we will see. The last time I mentioned briefly, this time we will see what are the four bridges which Sri Ramji built. So the first bridge we know very well from Tamil Nadu to Lanka, that's the bridge. But that had as a symbolism also, Lanka was known for its prosperity and indulgence in all kinds of the worldliness. They were very worldly, they were only pleasure seekers. It was said that height of materialism was that during the day, women used to get drunk. That was the state of Lanka. So we say, in our technical language, we say, Artha Kama, getting more and more and enjoying. Getting more and more money, somehow we get more and more things and then we enjoy them. Artha Kama, that was the Lanka symbolized Artha Kama. And before it's only Artha Kama, then we know very well that we will perish. Therefore, India, in Bharata, we call Bharata, not Bharata, that represents dharma. So linking Bharata with the Lanka represents, we are linking dharma with Arthakama. When you link dharma with Arthakama, then Arthakama becomes meaningful, it becomes dharmic, and slowly we are able to get over Arthakama and we go to moksha. So if dharma is there, slowly through dharma, with slowly Arthakama, slowly we gain vairagya, dispassion, and then slowly we go to kama. That is the first bridge we have to say. So Sri Rama is Bhagavan and Sita Devi is the Ananda, Paramananda, Atmananda, and the Ravana is the ego. Only when we will kill ego, then we can get Atmananda, which is Sita Devi. So that's symbolism of the bridge from India to the Lanka. The second bridge which the Sri Rama built was between. You see, when the Sri Rama and the Vanaras, they reached the seashore, they were thinking, now how do we cross the ocean? How do we cross the ocean was the question. So it was Vibhishna also there, and Lakshmana was also there. Vibhishna said, Oh Sri Ramji, oh Bhagavan, if we will do anything, let us pray to Varuna to give us a way through the ocean. And immediately Lakshmana became a little upset. He said, why should we pray? We are Kshatriyas, we are warriors. We can create a way through the ocean. So in the beginning, Lakshmana never liked Vibhishna, because Lakshmana knew that Vibhishna was the younger brother of the sworn enemy Ravana. So he was always suspicious of Vibhishna. Lakshmana never liked Vibhishna. Now come to the bridge construction. Finally, when the battle started, Lakshmana and Vibhishna became very, very close. They became so close that when Indrajit sent a very deadly missile to kill Vibhishna, Lakshmana came and stood in the way, and he got the missile. And because of strength, he saved Vibhishna from Indrajit's missile. They became so friendly. They became so close. So that is the second bridge, which the bridge Sri Rama built was the bridge between Lakshmana and Vibhishna. Now the symbolic meaning is Vibhishna represents prayer, divine grace. When we do anything, first we should have a prayer for divine grace. But as Amma said that in her example, she said that a person was traveling a vehicle, the vehicle broke down, and the person got on and sat and started praying, Oh Bhagavan, please get my vehicle out. And then the divine voice said, My dear son, why don't you push the vehicle and pray? So that means that we should, just divine grace is not enough, we should have self-effort also. So we can say, just before the exams, the children, they come with their pens and pencil and they give it to Amma. So Amma will bless it and give it. So they think that if they get Amma's blessing, the pen will write by itself. So that is not enough. So we have to know that we should see that there, divine grace is there where there is self-effort. So Vibhishna, first Sri Rama, he listened to Vibhishna. He first said, Lakshmana, you get my asana. The Sri Ramji sat down and he prayed for 3 days prayed to Varuna to give them way. Varuna did not appear. And then Sri Rama got up and he said, Lakshmana, bring my bow and arrows. The world has seen Rama's patience. Now the world will see Rama's anger. We know the story. And then Varuna appeared and then he said that I will support a bridge. We know the story. So first, Sri Rama listened to both. Sri Rama listened to Vibhishna and Sri Rama listened to Lakshmana also. Vibhishna represents prayer and divine grace. Lakshmana represents self-effort. Both should go hand in hand. Only when there is where there is self-effort, there will be divine grace. And if we expect divine grace through prayer, we should have self-effort also. So the second bridge is the bridge between prayer, the divine grace, and self-effort, both should go hand in hand. This is the second bridge. Now we come to the third bridge. The third bridge is, we know, all of us know very well that Vasishtha Rishi and Vishwamitra Rishi, they never got along together. They were always fighting, arguing. Usually Vishwamitra Rishi, he starts the fight. And Vasishtha usually is very, very, very patient and calm. We know this, we know that very well. Now here, the third bridge is bringing Vasishtha and Vishwamitra together. So the story is, we know very well, the Amma has told the story. The Vasishtha says, the Vishwamitra always say that tapas is greatest. By tapas we can achieve moksha. Whereas Vasishtha always say, satsang is superior. Through satsang we can attain moksha. Through the satsang means through the company, the company of the great saints. When we are in the company of the great saints like them, we can see how effortless our meditation is. When we are meditating in Amma's presence, our meditation becomes so effortless. So satsang is the physical nearness and also the mental nearness. It's not even that we sit near Amma and then we think of the construct a new house. That is not satsang. Sitting near Amma, we should think of Amma. That is the satsang. So we know how the Vasishtha and Vishwamitra they go to Brahmaji and ask for they ask which is better, which is superior. Brahmaji say, I don't know, you go to the Vishnu. Then they go to Vishnu and Vishnu says, you go to Ananda Shayana, the snake. And then the snake, the Ananda Shayana, the great snake, he says, now I am bearing the universe on my head, so I am not able to think. One of you please hold this, the universe, for a minute, then I will tell you the answer. So Vishwamitra, with all his power of the tapas, he tried to lift the universe. He could not. But Vasishtha, with his power of satsang, he could easily lift the universe. So we know this story very well. So Vasishtha and Vishwamitra never got together. But here what happened was, Sri Ramji built a bridge connecting Vasishtha and Vishwamitra. So what happened was, after this Sita Swayamvara, after they reached the Ayodhya, they were all sitting. Vasishtha got up and said, this is the happiest day of our lives. See what has happened. See, the Sri Ramji, Sri Rama and his three brothers, they have married and brought Sita Devi and her sisters. The happiest day of our life, and all this happiness is because of sage Vishwamitra. He praised sage Vishwamitra. All this happiness is because of sage Vishwamitra. He praised Vishwamitra. And you know very well, if you praise somebody, that person becomes restless. He will praise you back. Like for example, a few years back when I was when I was in Chennai, a famous person, he gave a very good satsang. And I was talking to him. I told him, sir, satsanga romba nalla irukku, very good satsang, I told him. And immediately became restless. Then he said, Sami, ungaloda anda amma nin roopam anda badane illa, adu romba nalla irukku. If you praise somebody, he will praise you back. This is the tendency. So in the same way, so then the Vasishtha praised Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra also, he said it is possible because the way Vasishtha trained these four boys, it is simply fantastic. The boys are so well behaved. They are so dharmic. It is all the greatness of these four princes, it is all due to the blessings and the training which Vasishtha has given them. So they became very close. So the third bridge is between Vasishtha and Vishwamitra. We say both are important. Satsang is important and tapas is important. Both are important, but satsang is first. We have in satsang, when we are in Amma, the Amma's presence, we are having satsang. Then now most of the devotees, you are doing tapas now. Now because you are away, physically away from Amma, even though in the evening we can see Amma, that is satsang. For 3 hours, we are with satsang, we get satsang. After that, you'll be thinking of Amma, that is tapas. Or here also, in the ashram also, when we get COVID, so we are about 17 days, we are in tapas. So satsang and tapas. All of us also get satsang and tapas. So this is the third bridge we are constructed, the importance of satsang and the importance of tapas. We should start with satsang, and then we should, the satsang is we are seeing our Amma outside, and gradually, best example is Bhagwan Shri Krishna and the gopis. In the beginning, when Shri Krishna was in Vrindavanam, the gopis were having satsang. But one day, Bhagwan Krishna, he suddenly went away without even telling them. Then from the, when Krishna departed to Mathura, from that time, it was tapas, and they finally saw Shri Krishna within themselves. So we have seen 3 bridges which Sri Ramji built. Now we will see, come to the fourth bridge. The fourth bridge is the bridge between Ayodhya and Mithila. Ayodhya was ruled by King Dasaratha, and Mithila was ruled by King Janaka. Sri Ramji brought Ayodhya and Mithila together. Sri Ramji brought Dasaratha and Janaka together. So that is another great symbol. Dasaratha is focused on the God with form. Most of us, we are all focused on God with form. We are all focused on Amma's divine form. So we start with the worship of God with form. There is a lot of controversy. Even in Hinduism, there are people who say that God does not have a form. God is formless, and another group who say that God is only with form. There is nothing called formless God. God is always form. The God with form is superior most. There are 2 groups in Hinduism, but we had to bring them both together. We can say that both are, in the beginning we say Om Murtaye Namaha, then we can say Om Amurtaye Namaha, both with form and without form. So Dasharatha, he was attached to Sri Ramji's form. He was so fond of the form. But Janaka, on the other hand, he was meditating on the formless God. We know the beautiful story of Ashtavakra. Ashtavakra came to Janaka, and how he made Janaka, inch by inch, he led Janaka into deep meditation, and he made him realize the formless God. When the mind became the Ashtavakra, Janaka was very trained in meditation. And therefore, the Janaka's mind became absolutely still. And when he became absolutely still, he merged his mind into the infinite. And he became a Jnani. So both are important. We start with worship of God with form, like Dasharatha. But we come to slowly to the worship of God with form. And finally, we come to the formless God. Both are equally important, and therefore, connecting Dasaratha and Janaka are connecting both God with form and God with the formless God. This point, I remember, I have already mentioned long time back. Especially, we have our Ayyappa also. In Ayyappa, usually the Vaishnavas, they worship God with form. They say God with form is superior, most supreme. The God with form is supreme. Whereas the Shaivas, the devotees of Shiva, they say that the infinite, the Nirguna, the formless God, the all-pervading God is supreme. So we can see there are always a lot of arguments, and therefore that is how we have Ayyappa. Ayya is Vishnu and Appa is Shiva. Ayyappa is the son of Vishnu and Shiva. So combining both, we have we start with the worship of God with form. Like they say Amma, so many times I give the example. First we see Amma so in front of us, and then we say that the power of seeing, power of hearing, power of smelling, tasting, they are all Amma's power only. Therefore, Amma is not only in front of us, Amma is inside us also. The inside us, we see, we feel Amma, the formless, the power behind all our senses and mind. In this way, we see the same Amma in every one of us. In every one of us, we have the same power, and thus we accept the entire creation as Amma's power. This is what we have seen. So we have seen four bridges which the Sri Rama has built. First bridge was, remember, it is the Bharata and the Janka connecting Dharma with Arthakama. Then we have Vibhishna and Lakshmana, that is self-effort and God's grace come together always. The third one is the Satsanga and Tapas. The Vasishta and Vishwamitra, first Satsanga, then we should do Tapas. Both are most important for Moksha. And last but not the least, worship of God with form. We begin with worship of God with form, and then we go to the formless God that we have, that is the thing. You see how they connect. Human beings, they are experts in building walls, in divisions. Whereas avatars, they are experts in building bridges, connecting people. Human beings usually, they build walls so that there are divisions. I cannot see my neighbor. So that is usually the human beings, because of their the limited knowledge. Whereas avatars, satsgurus, mahatmas, they are experts in building bridges, connecting everybody. In my last talk, I had also mentioned that regarding Tulsidas, he had said that Kudumbutaji does not mean running away from family. Kudumbutaji only means realizing that what I really want, I cannot get from my family. I can get only from God. I'll give you just one example. This is a newly married couple. A newly married couple, the father was a great devotee of a great Mahatma. The father asked the Mahatma, Swamiji, Maharaj, my son got married last week. Can I bring them to your ashram for your blessings? And the Swamiji said, please let them come in the evening. Please let them come. So the father brought the newly married couple to the sannyasi. So they blessed them both, and then he had kept three dishes in front of them. So the Swami said, he first opened one first dish and he said, now you take this and you offer to each other. So like a modest here. So both the husband and the wife, they took the sweet and they offered each other. It was very sweet. They were very happy. Then the Mahatma showed the second dish. Now you offer this to each other. So that was bitter gourd, karela, paveka, very, very bitter, boiled karela. So that also they ate, and we could see from the expression, it was very bitter. And then the Mahatma, he said, now immediately offer this also. The third dish was also again very sweet. So that after that was over, the Mahatma said, now listen, you like the sweet. The sweet was very, you like the sweet very much. But you did not like the taste of the bitter gourd. Bitter gourd you did not like, because bitter gourd is very bitter. But remember, the bitter gourd, it has iron content. Therefore, that bitter gourd, even though it is bitter, it gives strength to your body. Sweetest taste to your tongue, but the bitter gourd is iron content. It can give strength to your body. In the same way, you have every human being is a mixture of the happiness and sadness. In relationships, some relationship you get very the happy experiences, but some experience can be very sad, bitter experiences. So what you have to understand is that when you get happy experiences, that also that makes you happy. But when you get bitter experiences, that will make you tough. Bitter experience in your life should not lead you to depression. It should make you tough. You should understand that all human relationships are limited. I can get only limited happiness. Thus the Mahatma concluded the satsanga. And from there were a few others also, devotees. One devotee asked, Swamiji, can I ask a question? Yes. Swamiji, is there anyone whose only sweetness, because all human beings, they are a mixture of sweetness and bitterness, Swamiji, is there anyone who's only sweetness? And Swamiji said, yes, there is one person who's only sweetness. Swamiji, please tell me who that person, I want that person. And the Swamiji said, Atharam Madhuram, Vadanam Madhuram, Nayanam Madhuram, Hasitam Madhuram, Hridayam Madhuram, Gamanam Madhuram, Mathuradhipate, Akhilam Madhuram. Mathuradhipate, Akhilam Madhuram. Sri Krishna is only sweetness. Adharam Madhuram, his eyes are sweet, his face is sweet, his smile is sweet, his words are sweet, his walking, whatever it is sweet. And therefore, God alone can give you only sweetness. That is we can say that is connecting. So the connecting the couples also accept both when they give you happy experiences, when they give you happy experiences, accept them. When they give you bitter experiences, accept them also. That can toughen you. That is the meaning. Now we will connect because of Shivaratri, we'll briefly talk about Shivaratri and conclude. Now we are talking about Ramarajya. We say I should understand what we mean by Ramarajya. Ramarajya is a place where all living beings, not only human beings, all living beings, they live peacefully in harmony as one family, joyfully, sharing whatever they have. That is what we call as Ramarajya. In Kailas, we can see a very beautiful example. See, they say the Guru Gita begins with a beautiful shloka. They say, Kailasa shikare ramye moksha sadhana hetave pranamya pavrti bhaktya shankaram pariparchita. They say, on the beautiful peaks of the Himalayas, Kailasa shikare ramye. On the beautiful peaks of the Himalayas, Kailas Shikaramye, Moksha Sadhana Hetave Shankaram. The Shankara, Bhagavan Shiva and Parvati sitting there, and Shankara, Shiva, he is the Moksha Sadhana Hetu. That means we have different types of spiritual practices. We have Archana, we have the Japa, we have Dhyana, we have so many. The Vedic chanting, etc. We have different spiritual practices which can lead us ultimately to moksha, and moksha sadhana hetu. All those practices which lead to moksha, and he is the hetu, he is the support, and he has designed all these spiritual practices. Who is that? That is Shankara. So he knows how one can go to moksha, the practicing of all these techniques, all the spiritual techniques, we can go to moksha. Shankara, Bhagavan Shiva knows, and so therefore, Parvati, pranamya Parvati bhaktya Shankaram pariprachata. Parvati, with a lot of humility, she bows down and she asks Shiva, how can we go to moksha? So there, when we approach our guru, for knowledge, we should be very, very humble. That's why I say pranamya bhaktya. Parvati says, Parvati asks Shiva. So we say in Kailasa, when we say the higher we go, the lesser the differences. Now we can seek an example. We are sitting in this room. When we are sitting in this room, we can say, this is Suresh, this is Ramesh, this is Ramya, this is Soumya. We can see all the human beings closely, we can see all the differences. Now suppose we are standing on top of our building, 12th floor, when we look down, we can see that they are boys, they are girls. But we cannot say who's that boy and who's this girl, we cannot say. Difference become less and less. When we go in an aircraft, we can see only dark spots, we cannot even say whether that is a human being or an animal. So the higher we go, the lesser the differences. So in the same way, at the physical and the mental level, there are a lot of differences, but the higher when we go to our the When we go to Atma level, when we reach our Atma level, we can see Atma alone in all living beings. We can see Atma. That is what we mean by the Kailasa. This represents height where all differences are minimized, all differences are removed. And again, snow represents purity, and snow represents the compassion, purity, a pure heart. Snow melts very easily. In the same way, a pure heart, it melts because of lot of compassion. That heart melts very easily. That is the meaning of Kailasa Shikari, beautiful, the height of Himalaya. There we can see something very beautiful. We can see the animals and birds, which are the natural enemies, they are all living together. You can see, for example, the Parvati Devi's the Vahana vehicle is the lion, Keshari. And Bhagavan Shiva's vehicle is Rishabha, the bull, Nandi. So Nandi, the bull, and the usually when the lion sees the bull, it will jump and eat it. But here they are living very peacefully because of Bhagavan Shiva's presence and Parvati's presence. Because of the divine presence, these the Nandi, the bull, is no longer scared or frightened of the lion. Again, we can see the rat is the vehicle of Ganapati. And on Shiva, there is the cobra. The cobra will eat the rat. But the rat is not scared of the cobra because in that divine presence, they are both peaceful. And again, we can see Muruga, Subramanya's vehicle is the peacock. And peacock eats snakes. But we can see that the snake is not scared of the peacock because they are all part of one family. So the lion and the bull, they are friends. The rat and the snake are friends. The peacock and the cobra, they are all friends. And this is what we call as Ramarajya. All differences are removed in the divine, by the power of the divine presence. All differences are removed. We can see Shankaracharya, he wanted to establish a mutt in South India, and he was searching for a good place. When he came to a certain place, he saw that a pregnant frog was sitting and a cobra was giving it shade. Can you imagine? A cobra giving shade to a frog. When the cobra sees a frog, it will just gobble it, swallow it. But the pregnant frog was being given shade by the cobra. Immediately, Shankaracharya understood there must have been a very powerful, very divine Mahatma somewhere here. And he was told that there was a great Mahatma living here. Now he has created Samadhi. That place was very, very peaceful and divine. There he established the Sringeri Matam. This is story. I heard the story in this way. That is what we have to understand. And again, we can see when we are here, when we are sitting in this room, we can say, now I am phoning somebody. I am telling him, Suresh has gone. Suresh has gone, and Ramesh will be coming. So it is actually a past tense and a future tense. Ramesh has left, Ramesh has gone. Suresh has gone, Ramesh will be coming. For me, if we're sitting in this room, it is past tense and future tense. Whereas the same person when I'm phoning, he is on the 12th floor on the top of a building. He says no. He says Suresh is going, Ramesh is coming. He can see both. On top of the floor, he can see, I said, Suresh is gone. And Ramesh will come. But what he sees is, Suresh is going. He can see Suresh going. And he sees Ramesh coming. He tells me, no, Swami, Suresh is going. Yeah, Suresh is going, but Ramesh is coming. So the higher we go, we see that we have, there is no past tense, there is no future tense, there is no past and future. The past and future is only for us who are in the level of the mind. For Amma, there is only, she is in the highest state, for her everything is present. That is what we have to understand about Kailasa. And so when we say Shiva, we had this point we had mentioned many times. The Ratri, Navaratri or Shivaratri, we say the Ratri is the time of Boga, lot of enjoyment, and Boga and Vishrama, the time of enjoyment and the time of rest. But on these two Ratris, we keep awake, we think that all our achievements, when we see a lot of a big dinner in front of us, I say because of my intelligence and my efficiency, I earned all this money and then I am enjoying. But on Shivaratri, I remember, oh Bhagwan, it is not because of my intelligence and it is not because of my intelligence or not because of my efficiency. It is all because of your grace that I got everything. I am very thankful for you. So that if you remember, Bhagwan has given us everything on Shivaratri. On that night, I remember that I forget myself, my ego is gone. On Shivaratri, I remember that Shiva has given me everything. On Navaratri, we say the Devi has given the God and the Shiva is our father, Devi Durga is our mother. So I mentioned of Shivaratri because in other 2 days we have Shivaratri, and we will be able to offer. Let us not use the word celebrate. It's not a celebration. We sit with Amma and we do a lot of worship, lot of chanting, lot of mantras. We feel peaceful and let us pray for ourselves, for our family, and for the world peace. We can pray. One or two more the points I will say, and then I will stop. We see Shiva, and the Shiva on Shivaratri. Shiva, he lives in the bitter cold, the coldest part, the highest and the coldest part of the world is the mountain, the top of the mountain. So he lives there without any clothes. So that shows us he is not in this body consciousness. A person who has body consciousness cannot do that. We have in Kedarnath, etc., we have temple where there is completely surrounded by snow. There the priests, the pujaris, they wear 2 sweaters and do puja. Unlike the temples, in temples here, our pujaris, they don't wear a shirt. They remove the upper garment. But in Kedarnath, in the snow areas, they wear 2 sweaters and do the puja. Whereas Shiva Bhagwan, he's there also, he is bare bodied. That he had that so much of divine strength. We cannot do that. The divine power to endure the cold. So he is our first father. His children, let us try to learn a little dispassion. Let us with the power of endurance. And let us learn from Bhagwan Shiva. And our mother is Parvati. Parvati was born and brought up in the luxury of the palace. But after she married Shiva, she came out of the palace barefooted and she followed Shiva into the bitter cold. That is what our mother also set the example of the highest vairagya, the power of endurance and dispassion. So Amma's dear daughters, we sons also, Amma's dear daughters, let us not get carried away. Let us not run too much behind arthakama pleasures. So let us understand that we are children of Parvati and Shiva, who has so much of power of endurance and dispassion. So let us show at least 1% of their power of endurance and dispassion. And two more important points I will say and stop. You can see that by devotion alone can we get Amma. That is what the important point. We can see the Bhagavan Shiva and Parvati, they arranged a divine drama where the Parvati meditated for a long time, but Shiva did not open his eyes. The gods became impatient because they knew that the Tarakasura had a boon that only Shiva's son could kill Tarakasura. So they were, the Devas, they were very, very impatient. Somehow they wanted Shiva and Parvati get married so that a son is born and then the Tarakasura can be killed and then the Devendra can get back his Devaloka. Selfishness. So they came to assist. We know the story very well. Vasanta Deva, the lord of the spring, the seasons, the god of autumn. There's a lot of flowers are there. He came and created a lot of flower gardens in Kailasa. Lot of beautiful flower garden, it became very the romantic scene. And then Kamadeva, he shot his arrow, and we know that Bhagavan Shiva opened his third eye and he reduced Kamadeva to ashes. And Vasanta, the god of the autumn, the Vasanta Deva, he ran for his life. And therefore, it is a divine drama. Parvati was trying to teach us that I don't need anybody. Shiva is my God. I will gain Shiva by mere bhakti. I don't want any agent or any support. Therefore, the Bhagavan Shiva says, Amma says, you are my son, you are my daughter. Why do you need an agent? Come to me straight away. So by deep devotion, we can get Amma. That is the very important point. We don't need anybody to take us to Amma. We have real devotion. We can go straight to Amma. Amma will call us. In the old time, I remember very well. When Amma was sitting and talking, suddenly she said, "There is one person standing under the tree. Call him." So the senior Swami, they went to the place. The one person was crying. And Amma, he called him. So many of us have our experiences. Even when we are far away, she knows our sorrow and she has come to our rescue. I also have so many experiences. That is the important point, the drama, that we can gain Shiva, we can gain Parvati, our Amma, only through pure devotion. Let us remember that. And the last point is that Daksha Yaga, you can say Daksha Yajna became a Yuddha, Amma always used to say, because of his ego. So because Bhagavan Shiva said that you are very egoistic. If he is the goat, there's a beautiful shloka which says, the Kanta ime me, Tanaya ime me, Griha ime me, Pashvasti ime me, evam Naru Meshasaman Rupaha Me Kritaha Kala Vrikena Nitaha. This shloka means Kanta ime me, this is my wife. Tanaya ime me, these are my son children. Griha ime me, this is my house. Pashvasti ime me, these are all my animals, my elephant, my horse, my cow, etc. And evam naro mesha samanu rupaha, in this way the man behaves like a goat. Me kritaha kala vrikada nitaha, he goes on crying me my and becomes a prey to the wolf of time. The wolf of time devours man because of this kind of minus. And therefore the Bhagavan Shiva decided this, the Daksha is very, very egoistic. You always say meh like a goat, meh. So therefore, for you, best is a goat's head. So once the goat is killed, the skin is dried and it is pulled and fixed on the drum, on the tabla or on the mridangam. So when you tap it, it's like tum, 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 tum. God, I'm very sorry. I said, meh. I'm very sorry. I forgot. I'm very sorry for my arrogance, for my ego. I know everything is you only. Tum, 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 tum. That's why from the S-I-N, sin. So sin is any action performed which I did it is a sin because it causes bondage. Therefore, you remove the I from that sin and you put you, it becomes sun, light, knowledge. Remove the I and put the you, the sin becomes sun, knowledge, that is Atmajnana. In Christianity, you also say the cross, the I, cut the I, that is the cross. I. You cut the I, you have the cross. So the surrendering of the I is this what is required, and therefore offer the Sati Devi Parvati in her previous birth, when she was Daksha's daughter, she was Sati Devi or Dakshayani. So she taught to the world what is to be offered in the Yajna or Yaga. Daksha offered everything, but he did not offer his own ego, which is to be offered. Therefore she said, Father, what you did is wrong. So look, watch. And she offered herself into I have to offer myself to the Homa Kunda, I have to offer myself to God. And she offered herself. And that was the beautiful the example she kept. And for our Amma, the entire earth, the entire the universe is her Homa Kundam. Amma has offered herself into the entire universe. She has offered herself into the homokundam of the entire earth. Amma serves the entire universe. And we, Amma's children, let us also be like her. Let us practice, let us follow Amma's example, and let us also offer ourselves in this homokundam of the whole world and learn to serve the whole world. And by Amma's grace, let us become pure in heart, selfless, and then let us become useful first to our family, to the society, to the country, and finally to the entire world by our selfless service and devotion and surrender. Let us finally merge into Amma's feet. I offer these words to the lotus feet of Amma. Om Amriteshwari Namaha.
Thank you, Swamiji, for the wonderful satsang and giving us the example of the four bridges that Lord Sri Rama built. Let us try and quickly recollect the four bridges that Sri Rama built. The first bridge connects India, that is Bharata, and Lanka. India represents Dharma and Lanka represents Artha and Kama. The second bridge that Lord Sri Rama built was between Vibhishana and Lakshmana. Vibhishana represents divine prayer and divine grace. And Lakshmana represents self-effort. And these two should go hand in hand. The third bridge that Lord Sri Rama built is between Sage Vasishtha and Sage Vishwamitra, which represents that satsang and tapas need to go hand in hand. The fourth bridge that Lord Sri Rama built is between Ayodhya and Mithila. King Dasharatha, who worshipped the god with form, and King Janaka, who worshipped the formless, is what this particular story represents. In summary, we would like to pray to Amma to shower her divine blessings so that we can continue to do archana, chanting, meditation, and japa. Let us pray for Amma's divine grace. Om Amriteshwari Namaha.